Well, thank you very much, Standa. Yeah, I also wanted to emphasize that although maybe more majority of people here understand Czech, a number of Czech speakers will also be presenting in English. Part of the reason is that the recording will be available eventually online, and the recording will not have the simultaneous translation. But for everyone here, if you want the translation from either language, any of the three languages, to your preferred other language, then please take the headset. And now I'm going to open up this first session on the Communist Manifesto today, which will begin with a presentation by Michael Hauser, who is a researcher in philosophy at the Philosophy Institute of the Czech Academy of Sciences and at the Pedagogical Faculty of Charles University as well. It's worth mentioning he is one of the, or maybe the primary founder of the SOK, Association for Left Theory, that's one of the sponsors, the main organizer of this event, along with the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation as the sponsor. He has published a number of books and articles which, among other things, have helped to introduce the work of Theodor Adorno and Slavoj Žižek into Czech and Slovak audiences. He's also published some books, theoretical works on postmodernism and paths out of postmodernism and how to understand capitalism as a zombie in his terms. But today he'll be speaking on the resurrection of the specter of communism. So, floor is yours, Michael.
Participants in our conference, I would like shift the topic of the Communist Manifesto in a more seminal way, and to do this I would transpose the basic ideas of the manifesto into the contemporary situation. Firstly, we can see an inner tension into manifesto itself. If we read this text in details, we may get to know that at the one side we meet to Marx's depiction of some objective tendencies showing that to evolution goes beyond the limits of capitalism. First sight of the Communist Manifesto can be seen to develop the objective tendencies. But we come across another side of the message of the manifesto. That is the depiction of so-called revolutionary subjectivity embodied in the proletariat. And the tension between these two points consists in the fact that we can see the objective tendencies. Simultaneously, we can see the weakness of the revolutionary subjectivity, that is the proletariat. Firstly, I will focus on the objective tendencies as referred to in the Communist Manifesto. Marx and Engels tried to develop a dialectic picture of the bourgeoisie. This is why they engaged some references to the mythical figure of Prometheus. In a passage of the Communist Manifesto, we read that the bourgeoisie, during its rule, invented and established machinery, application of chemistry to industry and agriculture, steam navigation, railways, electric telegraphs, clearing of whole continents for cultivation, canalization of rivers, and so on. We can compare it to a passage in Aeschylus Prometheus, where we come across analogical words concerning the achievement which Prometheus brought. This is a symbol of progressive force of bourgeoisie. Of course, we can compare it with the contemporary achievements such as a means of communication, social medias, and so on. These are Promethean invention developed by the contemporary bourgeoisie. And other side of the bourgeoisie appears when we emerge into another passage in the Communist Manifesto. That is the depiction of the crisis engendered by capitalist development. I quote from the Communist Manifesto. On the one hand, it is the conquest of new markets. On the other hand, it is enforced destruction of a mass of productive forces. That is to say, by paving the way for more extensive and more destructive crises, and by diminishing the means whereby crises are prevented. Another side of the picture is formed by the consequence of the capitalist development. This is the fact that massive concentration of wealth takes place. I quote, in our existing society, private property is already done away with for 9/10 of the population. Its existence for the few is solely due to its non-existence in the hands of those 9/10. We can see that the massive development of productive forces led to a sharp division of society into two parts. On one side is the parts of one tenth of society, which huge property, and the other side is nine or tenth of society, as Marx put it, with existence without property. Now we get to the problem of the revolutionary subjectivity connected to the proletariat. Marx and Engels spoke about the fact that at that moment of social evolution, two laborers still form an incoherent mass scattered over the whole country and broken up by their mutual competition. If anywhere they unite to form more compact bodies, this is not yet the consequence of their own activity union, but of the union of the bourgeoisie, which class, in order to attain its own political ends, is compelled to set the whole proletariat in motion. So what we can see here is the fact that the laborers forms a passive object of the bourgeoisie movement. And why is it? This is because there is an inner obstacle to the formation of the proletariat as a class. And this obstacle consists in the fact that the principle of competition, of the principle of mutual competition, acts within the proletariat. We may remind of the book by Wendy Brown, that is the book which was published in the year of 2015. The name of the book is the undoing demos, the stealth revolution of neoliberalism. This author described there the neoliberal practices which are assumed or appropriated by workers. And one of the practices is self-managing. That means that each worker is to being whose goal is to accumulate or maximize his or her competitive capacity. And this is the problem of the inner obstacle to forming the class of the proletariat. But we can meet two incentives to form to formation of the proletariat as a class in the Communist Manifesto. First, it is the fact of poverty or existence without productive means, and into present days we can see that the huge majority of society is devoid of of a means of self reproduction to some extent, and we face the sharp polarization of society into proverbial 1% of the wealthiest and the remnant of society. This is a first incentive. The second one is is the fact that bourgeoisie created a means of communication. This means of communication enables the laborers to connect their activities and to create a net of organization of linkage and mutual relationships. But there is the third impetus to creation of the proletariat as a class. This is a remarkable impetus that is sought existence of communists. We can read in the Communist Manifesto that the communists are distinguished from the other working class parties by this only. Into national struggles of the proletarians of the different countries, they point out and bring to the front the common interests of the entire proletariat, independently of all nationality. Secondly, into various stages of development which the struggle of the working class against the bourgeoisie has to pass through, they always and everywhere represent the interests of the movement as a whole. This is an idea of an organization of communists which acts as a incentive to the formation of the class consciousness and the class such as. Incidentally, this is the passage which was the starting point of Lukács' scientific development concerning the role or the relationship between the Communist Party in an ideal shape and mass movement. To conclude, we can compare two tendencies described in the Communist Manifesto with the tendencies we face in the contemporary world. We can see that the tendency to the concentration of capital was strengthened, and even another tendency toward post-capitalism appeared that was or that has been threat of to of the climate catastrophe, as Naomi Klein in her book This Changes Everything, Capitalism and Climate Change, argued climate change may or the climate change is hard to imagine to resolve into limits of capitalism, and this really changes our understanding of capitalism and post-capitalism. But the appearance of the objective tendencies to post-capitalism changes our understanding of the idea of communism. Alain Badiou developed the concept of the idea of communism, which can be seen to be a Kantian or normative one to some extent. Alain Badiou marginalized the Marxian research on the objective tendencies. And what is necessary to do in the contemporary situation in the light of the Communist Manifesto is to connect to Badiou's type of communist idea with focusing on the so-called subjective conditions of its reappearing, with the other side, that is to analysis of the objective tendencies. The combination of the Badiou's idea of communism with Marx's political economy. Thank you for your concentration.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Is it on now? Now? Okay. Thank you very much, Mikhail. We'll now move on to our second speaker, and we'll discuss all three of the presentations at the end of the session. So let me now introduce Norbert Trenkel, who is a leading member of the Krisis group in, he's based himself in Nuremberg, and this is one of the leading groups that works through the tradition of so-called Wertkritik, and which may become clearer what that means in the course of his paper, the critique of capitalism through the concept of value, I guess would be a short version. He's also an editor and frequent author in the journal called Krisis that the group puts out, and has published a number of works, including his most recent book, written together with Ernst Lohoff, is called Die große Entwertung, which I suppose could be translated as the Great Abolition or Devalorization. Okay, devalorization. About the crisis of capitalist world system. But now I'll hand things over to you.
Thank you, Joe. Okay, this is on. Well, my presentation is called The Other Marx, Why the Communist Manifesto is Obsolete. So, Joe already said that we are a group that works on an interpretation on Marxism in a different way from the traditional Marxism, as we call it. And one of our main focus since 30 years, we exist more than 30 years as a magazine, is to criticize this focus of traditional Marxism on class struggle, because we say that the main focus should be on what we call the other Marx. Maybe this will be clearer after my presentation, I hope so. Well, at the most, since the great financial crisis of 2008, Karl Marx has again very rightly been regarded as highly up-to-date. However, his new and old friends are focusing on that part of his theory that historically is long outdated. The theory of the class struggle between the bourgeoisie and the proletariat. In contrast, the other Marx, as we call it, the critic of capitalism as a society based on generic commodity production, abstract labor, and the accumulation of value, receives little serious attention. But it is precisely this part of Marx's theory that allows us to adequately analyze the current situation of the capitalist world system and its crisis process. In contrast, class struggle theory contributes absolutely nothing to the understanding of the actuality, nor is it in condition to formulate a new perspective of social emancipation. For this reason, it must be said that the manifesto of the Communist Party is obsolete today. It has only historical value. Well, at a first glance, this may seem surprising, because considered by themselves, some of the sentences in the manifesto read like highly topical diagnosis of our time. When Marx and Engels write, for example, that the bourgeoisie, in its ceaseless urge to expand, has made the production and consumption of all countries cosmopolitan and pulled the national soil of industry away from under its feet. This reads like an anticipated diagnosis of the so-called globalization. Capitalism has undoubtedly established itself at a tremendous pace throughout the planet, almost completely destroying or marginalizing all other modes of production and living. It has transformed the vast majority of the world's population into sellers of labor power. Social polarization has taken on immense proportions, and financial wealth is concentrated in the hands of a tiny minority while the majority of people live in precarious condition. Isn't it obvious to speak of an intensification of the worldwide class contradiction in the sense of the manifesto and of a new class struggle like Slavoj Žižek does? Well, but the appearance is misleading. As correct as the diagnosis about the historical dynamics of capitalism may have been, the paradigm of class antagonism does not offer adequate explanations for current developments. First of all, there is a fundamental reason for this. The opposition of capital and labor was and is by no means an antagonistic contradiction that must blow up capitalism as Marx and Engels formulated in the manifesto. Rather, it is an immanent conflict of interests within a common social system of reference that is based on a general production of commodities and in which social wealth assumes the abstract form of value. The fact that this conflict of interest is often fought out in hard ways and repeatedly takes violent forms lies in the logic of matter. But ultimately, it is a distribution conflict, a conflict about how the mass of value produced is divided between the two parties, capital and labor. But since both parties take the capitalist form of wealth production, that is a production of abstract wealth, for granted, they also have a common interest in preserving it despite all the differences. That is why they generally respect the rules of the game dictated by this form of wealth. First and foremost, this means for both parts that the accumulation of capital must continue. Otherwise, capital will not be able to fulfill its end in itself motion to turn money into more money, nor will the sellers of labor power have the money they need to make a living. This basic commonality is the deeper reason why the opposition between capital and labor has not blown capitalism apart, as predicted in the manifesto, but rather, in the course of the 20th century, there were found ways to negotiate and politically regulate a balance between the different interests. Historically, the peak of this regulation of interests between capital and labor was in the era of Fordism. This is no coincidence. For in this era, capital expanded at a historically unique pace and therefore constantly needed new workers. Conversely, this allowed the sellers of labor power to negotiate relatively good conditions for selling their commodity and to participate in the social wealth to an extent previously unimaginable. The break in this historical constellation did not take place with the collapse of the so-called socialism, as is usually claimed today. Rather, it can be located 1.5 decades earlier. The reason for this was the end of Fordist boom, which was accompanied by the emergence of the third industrial revolution. This meant a qualitative leap in the development of productive forces, because with it, knowledge became the main productive force and displaced the work that had previously held this position, just as Marx had already predicted in the Grundrisse. The result was a mass displacement of labor force from production. This improved the bargaining position of capital, which was able to reduce wages and worsen working conditions. At the same time, however, with the large scale labor the capital lost the basis for its own valorization. The consequence of this was a profound crisis in the valorization of capital, which lasted well into the 1980s. A way out of this crisis, despite all the harsh neoliberal measures to weaken the trade union positions and deregulate working conditions, was not found in a renewal of the productive basis of realization. This was not even possible because the level of development of productivity once achieved cannot be reversed. There can therefore be no return to a constellation in which capital is valorized by exploiting labor in a large scale. Instead, the neoliberal deregulation and transnationalization I didn't speak 50 minutes, sorry, 10.
Okay.
Sorry. I took the time
from
my paper. Instead, the neoliberal deregulation transnationalization of the financial markets opened the door to a new era of capital accumulation that was no longer primarily based on the capital valorization. The main role of the production of surplus value was now replaced by the accumulation of fictitious capital. Fictitious capital is nothing more than the anticipation of future value, of value that has not been produced yet, but which is already taking effect today. The technical means to achieve this are financial titles that represent the claim to a certain sum of money and its multiplication through interest or dividends. The mass production of such financial titles like stocks, bonds, futures, etc., and their trading on the financial markets has allowed capital to continue to grow for almost four decades now, even though the basis for extensive surplus value production has long ceased to exist. The fundamental crisis of capital valorization, which originated in the 1970s, has therefore never been resolved. Rather, it was and is suppressed by the massive accumulation of fictitious capital on the financial markets. This accumulation of capital without valorization, which is a term introduced by my colleague Ernst Lohoff, which whom I wrote this book, Joe mentioned, this accumulation without valorization is unsustainable in the long term because it leads to a growing accumulation of explosive crisis potential on the financial markets. Yet it has been the engine of a tremendous capitalist expansion that has led to the final imposition of capitalist production and living throughout the planet. At the same time, however, in this era of fictitious capital, the relationship between capital and labor has changed fundamentally, and so fundamentally that the theory of class contradiction finally loses all basis. At first glance, this statement may seem surprising. Obviously, the vast majority of the world's population today is more dependent on wage labor and commodity production than ever before in history. However, at the same time, capital has largely become independent of the exploitation of labor power, because the focus of accumulation has shifted to the fictitious capital. Of course, this is not to claim that labor is no longer being exploited in any time, in any way. To claim this would be obviously against the fact. However, the production of surplus value has long ceased to be the engine of capital accumulation, and the production of surplus value has itself become a dependent variable moved by the dynamics of fictitious capital. Now here is this more evident, nowhere is this more evident than in the construction sector, which is a central point of reference for the accumulation of fictitious capital. People will only find a possibility to sell their labor force there if the accumulation of fictitious capital goes on. The price that labor has to pay for this dependence from the fictitious capital is, of course, extremely high. Extremely high. Because capital is no longer dependent on labor in its accumulation, it can largely dictate its conditions of sale. This is the decisive reason for the all-around precarization and intensification of labor, which goes hand in hand with the extensive loss of power of the trade unions. At the same time, there is a tremendous concentration of wealth in fewer and fewer hands, because fictitious capital can accumulate on the financial markets in direct relation to itself without the annoying detour via the employment of labor in the production of commodity. Despite this shift to the accumulation dynamics to the financial markets, however, the ruthless exploitation of natural resources is being accelerated. It is precisely because production is carried out at an incredibly high level of productivity that material consumption is increasingly tremendously. The individual unit of commodity represents less and less value because it can be produced with a minimum of manpower. But in order to at least partially compensate for this, the output and distribution of goods is permanently increased. All in all, in the era of fictitious capital, working and living conditions worldwide have become increasingly unbearable, while at the same time the natural environment is destroyed to a horrendous degree. Climate change is the most extreme and dangerous expression of this. Well, this of course provokes resistance, but the various forms of critique, protest, and resistance are largely fragmented and at the best externally related. There is no common point of reference by which they could connect. This is why parts of the left have recently been trying to rehabilitate the working class as a synthesizing category. But even if the claim to overcome fragmentation is right, the category of class cannot do much about it. What connects the different approaches of critique, protest, and resistance is not that they are all fragments of a worldwide class subject that only have to be brought together. That would imply a common positive meta-interest and a kind of presupposed class unity that simply does not exist. What connects the different forms of resistance is rather a negative point of reference. They are all provoked in different ways by lines of conflict determined by the imperial and destructive dynamics of the production of abstract wealth. This connection, however, remains invisible if there is no critical concept of this form of wealth production. Because the effects of this dynamic are empirically very different. At present, four lines of conflicts in particular are virulent in the capitalist centers. The question of housing, climate change, the precarization of working conditions, and immigration. They all result directly from the specific trajectory of abstract wealth production in the era of fictitious capital and the fundamental crisis of capital valorization. For the three lines of conflicts, I have already briefly outlined this relationship above, but the connection is also obvious for the large rush of immigration to the capitalist centers. People mostly flee because their previous living conditions have been destroyed by the force of capitalization, but at the same time they are not needed as workers. They are superfluous people who capitalism produces massively at the current level of productive power. Whoever tries to bring all these issues in lines of conflict, please give me two more minutes, it's just a little bit. Whoever tries to bring all these issues and lines of conflict to the common denominator of an overarching class interest must fail. There is no such thing. On the contrary, the interests along the various lines of conflicts are often even diametrically opposed. For example, when the precarized in the capitalist centers fear that immigration will cause working conditions to deteriorate further and housing prices to rise even more. Or when the climate policies threaten jobs in the industry and drive up costs of gasoline, heating and electricity. In this way, attempts of resistance are not brought together, but come into conflict, which is the other. An anti-capitalist synthesis can therefore produce only in a common confrontation against the capitalist form of wealth production. That is less abstract than it sounds at the first glance. On the one hand, it is possible to show very concretely and on the basis of each individual line of conflict what their negative common ground consists of. On the other hand, this results in a common perspective of social emancipation which can only consist in the abolition of abstract wealth production and in realizing a society of freely associated individuals. And finally, on this background, concrete demands, measures and practical steps can be developed that point in this direction and allow the seemingly disparate moments of resistance to be brought together. What the class discourse always primarily questions the who, that is, the presumed actor of emancipation, the determined negation of abstract wealth production provides very clear answers to the what, that is, to the content of the process of social emancipation. The questions about the actors of this process then answers itself as by itself. Since the actors do not exist a priori, they can only constitute themselves in relation to the emancipatory content along the various lines of conflict. They, the actors, can refer to the manifesto of the Communist Party only in one respect, to the great revolutionary impetus it transports. As far as the content of emancipation is concerned, however, they must refer to the other Marx, that part of the Marx theory that the traditional left still largely ignores. Thank you for the minutes.
Thank you very much. And there's a good conversation going on between the different papers. Now let me present Lubica Kobová, who is a philosopher in the Department of Gender Studies at the Faculty of Humanities of Charles University, has written fairly extensively on feminist theory, historical materialism, women's work under capitalism, the vulnerability of working bodies, and a number of these intersections of different theoretical traditions, but I'll now turn the floor over to her. So here you go, Lubica.
Ja budem hovoriť slovensky.
So get your headsets ready.
Dobre. Budem ten príspevok teda prevažne čítať. V svojom príspevku by som rada uvažovala nad možnosťami, ktoré dnes pred nás predkladajú manifesty politik, ktorých dedičkami a dedičmi sa cítime byť. V tomto socialistickom kruhu je takým zakladajúcim manifestom manifest komunistickej strany, respektíve komunistický manifest, ako ho asi častejšie poznáme, ktorý, teraz mi odpuste zjednodušenie, ktorých bude proste veľa, spočíva predovšetkým v nejakej artikulácii antikapitalizmu. Uvažovanie o tom komunistickom manifeste chcem rozšíriť ešte o uvažovanie nad dedičstvom feminizmu ako sociálneho a politického hnutia, ktoré zase, zjednodušujem, má ako hlavný zámer emancipáciu žien. Samotná skutočnosť zo 70. výročia vydania komunistického manifestu preto, ako sa k tomu manifestu budeme vzťahovať, podľa mňa znamená pomerne málo. Jako je pozoruhodné, že manifest prežil, ale podoba manifestu sa utvára v tom, ako ho analyzujeme, ako ho interpretujeme a tiež ako ho prípadne uchopujeme preto, aby sme pomocou neho robili politiku. Lebo, ako vlastne upozorňuje napríklad James Martin, ale myslím, že aj mnohí ďalší, citujem, manifest nie je len pojednaním o politike, ale jeho argumenty sú jeho politikou. Koniec citátu. Manifest, a teraz mám na mysli všetky manifesty v zásade, ktoré pokračujú v tradícii komunistického manifestu, je performatívnym žánrom. Ak sú splnené isté okolnosti, za ktorých sú slová prenášané, tak vyslovenie výpovede znamená vykonanie činu. Domnievam sa, že zároveň s tým, ako manifest predstavuje istú deskripciu alebo teóriu kapitalistickej spoločnosti, tak je aj, a z môjho pohľadu predovšetkým, politickou intervenciou, ktorej cieľom je, opäť citujem Martina, presvedčiť obecenstvo, aby prijalo a podporilo istý postoj vo vzťahu k tomu opisu stavu spoločnosti. Koniec citátu. Keď sa teda teraz vzťahujeme ku komunistickému manifestu, nemôžeme sa vyhnúť otázke po tom, či bol performatív manifestu úspešný a či teda vykonal, čo tvrdil. Toto hodnotenie manifestu je fakticky pars proto posúdením úspešnosti modernizačného revolučného projektu socializmu a komunizmu. Ak však zároveň nechceme nad manifestom uvažovať len ako nad textom, ktorého pôsobnosť určujeme my našim vzťahovaním sa k jeho minulosti, ale ak chceme uvažovať nad manifestom ako nad textom, ktorý sa z povahy svojho obsahu aj formy šíri do budúcnosti, a je tak stále nejakou predstavou o budovaní hegemonického politického subjektu, tak si myslím, že potrebujeme vlastne uvažovať o premene politického pola ako takého. Ak teda chceme zvážiť, čo je živé a čo je mŕtve v komunistickom manifeste, tak je potrebné preskúmať pôsobenie manifestu v tomto premenenom politickom poli. Myslím, že stručne by sa to premenené politické pole dalo pomenovať ako poprvé demokracia, teda také usporiadanie, citujem Aletu Norval, teda také usporiadanie, v ktorom sa miesto moci stáva prázdnym, stáva sa miestom, ktoré nemôže byť obsadené, koniec citátu. A po druhé, toto premenené politické pole charakterizuje zmnoženie sociálnych antagonizmov mimo ten jeden hlavný antagonizmus marxistickej ortodoxie, nazvime to tak, teda antagonizmus práce a kapitálu. Vlastne spravím v tomto príspevku v zásade iba nejaké dva jednoduché kroky. Chcem sa vlastne zamerať najskôr na manifest ako, a takisto na teda komunistický manifest a feministický manifest ako žáner, ktorý vlastne ako má schopnosť niesť nejaké konkrétne politické obsahy. A v druhom kroku vlastne budem chcieť preskúmať asi iba veľmi stručne alebo opísať jeden zo socialisticko-feministických manifestov, možno populárny v súčasnosti, Feminizmus pre 99%, ktorý bol publikovaný na začiatku tohto roku. Pôvodne som chcela hovoriť aj o kyborgskom manifeste Donny Haraway z roku 1985, ale možno v diskusii alebo niekedy inokedy. Budeme sa snažiť vlastne poukázať hlavne na tie miesta tohoto manifestu, ktoré by mohli byť oporou pre uvažovanie o demokratickej politike, ktorá je vlastne ukotvená v princípoch feminizmu a socializmu. Teda prvom kroku ku komunistickému manifestu. Napriek tomu, že komunistický manifest nie je prvým moderným politickým manifestom, je fakticky exemplárnym príkladom tohto žánru, ktorý nadväzuje na písomné a rečnícke tradície francúzskej revolúcie. Je podstatne odlišný napríklad od deklarácie alebo petície. Na rozdiel od petície, ktorá sa vlastne dovoláva vyslyšania u nejakej existujúcej moci, ktorú ako takú ten petent alebo petenti v zásade ako rešpektujú a musia rešpektovať, je manifest bojovný a vlastne ten existujúci poriadok, mocenský poriadok nepríjma. Hoci podľa Janet Lyon, ktorá napísala celú knihu o manifestoch, o žánri manifestu, manifestom preniká viacero temporalít, tak tým časom, ktorý väčšinou čitateľku a čitateľa zaujme a unáša, je tzv. Čas manifestu. Je to nejaké urgentné teraz manifestu, ktoré vlastne predstavuje nejakú ruptúru medzi tým, čo bolo a čo bude alebo môže byť. Podľa Blanchota, ktorý vlastne v súvislosti s Marxovým písaním hovorí o troch Marxových hlasoch, o hlase filozofickom, politickom a vedeckom, je hlas manifestu vlastne politickým hlasom, ktorý už, a teraz Blanchot vlastne ako hodne extrapoluje, ale myslím, že práve preto uchopenie toho teraz je to dôležité, je tento politický hlas hlasom, ktorý už, citujem, nenesie význam, ale je volaním, je násilím, je zlomovým rozhodnutím. Presnejšie povedané, tento hlas nič nehovorí. To, o čo sa tu jedná, je urgentnosť oznamu. Koniec citátu. Komunistický manifest v svojom úvode sebavedomo sprítomňuje komunizmus ako všade prítomnú moc, ktorej sa ľudia obávajú a ktorá vlastne má to žiť ako strašidlo. A ktorú už všetky európske politické mocnosti uznávajú za moc. Myslím, že tu hneď na začiatku manifestu je vlastne ako vidieť tá urgencia. Urgentnosť sebadefinície komunizmu je posilnená zároveň dôrazom na jeho otvorenosť. Komunizmus sa nechápe ako ďalšia socialistická frakcia, ktorá sa chce vymedziť voči ďalšej socialistickej frakcii a v nejakom kódovanom alebo ezoterickom jazyku, ktorý je zrozumiteľný iba zasveteným, bude definovať svoje odlišnosti. Ten čas manifestu sa vlastne viaže, je teda časom nejakého teraz, kedy sa otvorene vykladá politický zámer a poslucháči a poslucháčky, v zásade ľudstvo ako celok, teraz a v budúcnosti, sa prizývajú k projektu manifestu. Citujem z manifestu, vlastne z úvodnej strany manifestu. Je najvyšší čas, aby komunisti pred celým svetom otvorene vyslovili svoje názory, svoje ciele i úsilia a aby proti báchorkého strašidlu komunizmu postavili manifest samej strany. Koniec citátu. To je jeden znak teda manifestu, komunistického manifestu, ktorý považujem za dôležitý, ako urgencia, dôraz na teraz. Ďalšiu vec, ktorú manifest podľa môjho názoru robí, je opis stavu vecí, deskripcia toho, čo vidíme okolo. Najmä vlastne v prvej kapitole, alebo v tej prvej časti o buržoázii a proletariáte, manifest podáva istý opis stavu vecí, istý stav poznania. Vlastne to teraz, ktoré bolo vymknuté z nejakej temporality, sa začleňuje zase do temporality inej. Vzťah vlastne medzi buržoáziou a proletariátom je vlastne uchopený iba ako jedna fáza nejakej dlhej dejnej drámy triedného boja, v ktorom vystupuje a dostáva sa do popredia kolektívny agens manifestu proletariát. Keď komunistický manifest opisuje veci, tak je jeho jazyk veľmi prístupný a úsporný a je jazykom racionálneho vysvetlenia. V manifeste ako keby nebol čas na odhalovanie nejakých komplexných vzťahov. Z retorického alebo štylistického hľadiska vlastne manifest používa priraďovací sklad, parataxu. Radí vety jednu za druhou, bez toho, aby vlastne podraďoval a ukazoval na nejaké komplexnější vzťahy. Jako ten, věci se opisují v úvodzovkách tak, jako jsou. Ako by vlastně jako dávali ty vety v manifeste, ako by dávali nějaký jasný význam světu a je teda jednoznačně ho opisovali v zmysle, věci se mají tak a tak. Narácia manifestu je všeobsiahla a výklad dejín postupuje rýchlo a hladko až k samotnej revolučnej ruptúre, ktorá sa deje teraz a vyplýva akoby samozrejme z predchádzajúceho výkladu. Opäť citujem z manifestu. Načrtli sme najvšeobecnejšie fázy vývinu proletariátu, čím sme sledovali viac menej skrytú občianskú vojnu v terajšej spoločnosti až do chvíle, keď prepuká v otvorenú revolúciu a proletariát násilným zvednutím buržoázie zakladá svoje panstvo. Koniec citátu. A myslím vlastne, že najmä tam, kde ten manifest vlastne situuje svojho čitateľa do pozície partnera v polemike a fakticky z neho vlastne robí príslušníka buržoázie, čo sa deje vlastne v druhej časti manifestu, s ktorým sa teda príslušníkom buržoázie, s ktorým sa ten manifest samotný ocitá v konflikte, je vlastne manifest veľmi presvedčivý. Tým, že manifest vlastne ako necháva čitateľa obsadiť pozíciu oponenta komunizmu, počíta s tým, že vo výsledku sa čitateľ bude od tejto pozície chcieť zásadne dištancovať. Toto jasné adresovanie v druhej osobe množného čísla sa vlastne ako deje prostredníctvom takých prehovorov ako hovoríte o, desíte sa, vyčítate nám, ako nám komunistom, vyhlasujete, vy buržovia, priznávate teda, vravíte. A toto všetko vlastne adresovanie, oslovovanie v druhej osobe vyzýva k zaujatiu pozície a je zároveň prepletené vlastne nejakým ako racionálnym a vlastne ako neutrálnym výkladom vykorisťovania v kapitalizme. A myslím, že vlastne ako v tomto spojení ako nejaké racionality a vlastne apelu na emocionalitu, ak to tak nazveme, vlastne spočíva zásadný účinok komunistického manifestu. A myslím, že ten zásadok, myslím, že teda ten účinok komunistického manifestu sa do nejakej miery tvorí aj v genderovej ideológii manifestu ako takého. V abstrakte som avizovala, že sa budem zaoberať vlastne nejakým genderovou ideológiou, nie v zmysle, ako sa o nej hovoríte teraz, genderovou ideológiou mám naozaj na mysli vlastne nejaké predstavy o genderovém řádu, o rodovom usporiadaní, rodovom poriadku spoločnosti. Ja vlastne načrtnem iba jednu jedinú vec a inak teda odkazujem na texty Shirley Robotham a Joan Tronto. Práve vlastne v druhej kapitole vlastne v druhej kapitole sa ukazuje retorický apel na vlastne veľmi konkrétnu predstavu o osobnosti toho, komu je manifest adresovaný. Oh, sorry. Můžu pokračovat? OK, díky. OK, perfekt. V zásadě moje tvrdění je asi následovné. Manifest předpokládá mužského proletára jako svojho modelového čitatela. A deje sa to napríklad prostredníctvom moralizácie, prostredníctvom moralizácie jednej konkrétnej časti, práve druhej kapitoly, ktorá sa týka zrušenia rodiny a spoločenstva žien, vlastne notorických tém manifestu a potom pôvodu rodiny. Podľa John Tronto sa práve tu ukazuje vlastne obmedzenie manifestu tou genderovou ideológiou, pretože ženy a deti sa tu ako predvádzajú alebo sú reprezentované ako tie, ktoré potrebujú mužskú ochranu. Skutočnosť, že ženy a deti sú donútené pracovať v platenom zamestnaní, ide podľa manifestu ruka v ruke s úpadkom rodiny. S, citujem, bezrodinným životom proletárov. Koniec citátu. Manifestu obvinuje buržoáziu z toho, že vidí vo svojej žene iba výrobný nástroj. A z toho buržoa vyvodí, že ak sa výrobné nástroje majú používať spoločne, tak si nevie pravdu, že predstaviť nič iné, len to, že rovnaký údel postihne aj ženy. Koniec citátu. V tomto mieste vlastne ten manifest robí jeden zo svojich častých manévrov. Vlastne on prevracia, invertuje to, čo bolo pripisované jednému aktérovi a pripíše to tomu aktérovi opačnému. Manifest tvrdí, že komunisty nemusia zavádzať spoločenstvo žien, pretože to jestvovalo vždy. Buržoázne manželstvo, tvrdí manifest, je v skutočnosti spoločenstvom manželiek, z ktorého vyplýva oficiálna a neoficiálna prostitúcia. Čo sa tu vlastne podarí vytvoriť, je predstava žien ako aktuálnych aj potenciálnych obetí zlej buržoázie, vlastne sexuálnej žiadostivosti buržoáznych mužov. Ženy, ktoré pracujú v továrni, mimo domova, sa vlastne ako stávajú potenciálnymi obeťami sexuálnych predátorov. Rovnako tak manželky vlastne ako buržoáz sú považované len za nejaké výrobné nástroje, za súčasť spoločenstva manželiek. A tu sú teda súčasťou toho, čo sa nazýva oficiálna prostitúcia. A potom je tu neoficiálna prostitúcia ako taká. Všetky tieto rôzne skupiny žien sú teda zahrnuté do jednej skupiny ako obete buržoáznych mužov. Komunisti vlastne ako tvrdia, že v prípade komunizmu toto spoločenstvo žien práve naopak, oproti tomu, čo sa namieta, prestane existovať. A spoločenstvo žien ako také je v zásade ako vlastnosťou buržoáznej spoločnosti. Čo je vlastne ako zaujímavé, alebo ten výsledok ako tohto malého rozboru je to, že v tejto časti ako manifest sa snaží spochybniť vlastne ako morálny kredit mužských zástupcov buržoázie a snaží sa postaviť vlastne proletárov do nejakej pozície ochrancov žien. A je to vlastne tiež nejaký spôsob, cez ktorý, alebo je to jeden zo spôsobov, cez ktorý vlastne funguje a pôsobí práve ako retorika manifestu, o ktorom si myslím, že je vlastne vždy textom, ktorý je vlastne veľmi časový, kontextuálny a vlastne musí byť čítaný na nejakých konkrétnych miestach a v konkrétnom čase. Nemám veľa času, tak možno možno preskočím niektoré časti a budeme sa snažiť prísť na to, čo je pre mňa vlastne ako dôležité. Chcela som hovoriť o vlastne tradície feministických manifestov, ktoré ani tak veľmi nesledujú komunistický manifest, ale vychádzajú z tradície radikálneho feminizmu druhej vlny. Radikálny feminizmus zdieľa vlastne s komunistickým manifestom veľa spoločných črt. Je to predovšetkým predstava vlastne jedného základného antagonizmu, ktorý vlastne nespočíva ale v triednom útlaku, ale v útlaku genderovom. V istom zmysle vlastne môžeme povedať, že radikálny feminizmus ako opakuje alebo vlastne využíva vlastne veľmi, alebo manifesty radikálneho feminizmu využívajú ako veľmi podobnú politickú logiku. Chcela som hovoriť o tom, že vlastne v súčasnosti myslím vidíme obrovský nárast feministických manifestov. Môj problém so súčasnými feministickými manifestami je asi ten, že fakticky nie sú nástrojmi budovania nejakého hegemónneho politického subjektu na lavici, ale v zásade sú stranickými knižkami feministiek v tom zmysle, že vlastne majú im nejakým spôsobom prisúdiť identitu feministky. Otázka pre mňa znie, či existuje vlastne ako nejaký feminizmus, ktorý by usiloval o utvorenie, ktorý by usiloval vlastne o utvorenie nejakého politického hegemónneho aktéra. Moja domnienka, alebo vlastne môj návrh by spočíval vo vyložení práve feminizmu pre 99%. Ktorý vlastne tvrdí, že chce chce vystoupit proti neoliberálnímu feminismu a chce vlastně vycházet především vlastně z antikapitalistického stanoviska. Samotný feminismus pre 99% ako formálne kopíruje obrovské množstvo vlastne nejakých ako žánrových črt komunistického manifestu ako takého. Má 11 téz, začína popisom krízy súčasného kapitalizmu ako generalizovanej krízy, buduje ako jasný antagonizmus medzi 1% a 99%. Zakončím tým, že podľa môjho názoru robí zaujímavú prácu na vlastne ako budovaní toho politického subjektu, ktorý, bolo tu povedané napríklad, nemôže ním byť jednoducho uchopená trieda. A myslím, že feminizmus pre 99% robí zaujímavú prácu na uchopení politického subjektu v tom, že hovorí o tom, že je tu veľké množstvo rôznych typov útlaku, ktoré sú, a tu sa podľa mňa ukazuje nejaký marxistický tradicionalizmus feminizmu pre 99%, ktorý možno spočíva v ekonomickom determinizme, ktoré sú spôsobené antikapitalizmom, ale čo je pre utvorenie tohto politického subjektu dôležité, je vzájomná artikulácia odlišností a v zásade prekonávanie rozdielov v spoločnom boji.
Výborně, ďakujem. First, before we open the floor, since this panel started a few minutes late, I don't know if we have permission to go a few minutes over. All right, so we have time for a few questions now, so let's open up the discussion to all three papers. Maybe while the audience is collecting its thoughts, I could pose one question that I think really jumps out from the collection of these papers, which is the category of class, which Norbert criticized heavily, the way class is presented in the manifesto, whereas Misha and Luba seem to be a bit more sympathetic to class potentially, but I wonder if we could pose the question to whoever wants to answer how, whether either on the one hand this critique of class should be taken into account when we reinterpret the manifesto today, or on the other hand whether it's still possible to take the manifesto with this reinterpreted understanding of class if we accept the Werth critique criticism, but still find class to be relevant in some way, even if it's understood maybe in a different way than the orthodox interpretation. So whoever wants to volunteer to stick your neck out first.
Můžu mluvit slovensky? Možná, anebo začala jsem česky. Myslím, že to sú dve, z môjho pohľadu sú to dve veľmi odlišné otázky. Či je vlastne koncept triedy a dajme tomu aj triednej politiky relevantný a do aké miery je relevantný manifest. Ja som vlastne svoju prezentáciu a svoj paper chcela zakončiť takým ako volaním potom, že práve manifest ako a naše vracenie sa k manifestu samotnému a možno aj k nejakým pojmom sa môže stať ako momentom, ktorý Wendy Brown a myslím, že teraz vlastne Enzo Traverso vlastne a predtým Walter Benjamin vlastne pomenovali ako lavicovú melanchóliu. Ako vlastne skutočne vracanie sa k nejakým veľmi drahým ako ideálom a princípom, ktoré vlastne už stratili nejakú ako vypovedaciu a diagnostickú hodnotu a vlastne ako si ich uchovávame ako nejaké ako drahé poklady nášho dedičstva, ale fakticky už nemôžu spraviť žiadnu užitočnú teoretickú alebo politickú prácu. Ja nemám vlastne ako na tú otázku ani jako relevantnosti komunistického manifestu, ani jako konceptu triedy a triedného boja úplně jako jednoznačnou odpověď. V zásadě mám vlastně skôr iba také jako keby varovanie alebo jako nabádanie na opatrnosť v vlastně nějakom nekritickom alebo vlastně v doslovnom vzťahovaní se a interpretovaní vlastně jako toho, čo tu máme jako dědičstvo. V zásadě například podle feminismu pre 99% sa koncept triedy jako zásadně premieňa. Protože feminismus pre 99%, takže jako například odpověď z pohledu feminismu pre 99% je, koncept triedy a triedného boja je nadalej relevantný, ale podstatně se premieňa pojem triedy a to právě kvůli tomu, protože se premieňa chápanie toho, čo vlastně jako tvorí základný jako motor kapitalismu, kterým je vlastně okrem výroby pre zisk aj vlastně znevažovanie fakticky jako toho, čo nazývá feminismus pre 99% sociálna reprodukcia alebo produkcia ľudí.
Thanks.
If I can react to both speakers. Firstly, I would say that the concept of fictitious capital, which Norbert spoke about, is questionable to some extent. I rely on to book by David Harvey called Marx, Capitalism and Madness of Economic Reason. David Harvey introduced the concept of anti-value. And he balances these two concepts, the anti-value and value. And what it seems to me is that when we cut off the concept of value, it is hard to explain to crisis or to permanent crisis of fictitious capital. This is my first point. And the second one is that certainly we miss a common denominator for different forms of resistance, as you spoke about, both of you, as a matter of fact. I would say that the common, so-called common denominator is and cannot be pre-given. It is no commonplace to have a common denominator. And I would pay attention to role of so-called the Communist Party in the manifesto. It is an ideal entity, the Communist Party in the manifesto. Construction to some extent, but Communist Party is the agent who is in position in a position to form and mold the common denominator in a course of different struggles. And what we miss is the Communist Party in this position. Yo, this is the main principal problem in our different struggles.
Well, I think it would be difficult to discuss here the concept of fictitious capital because it leads quite away. Just one answer, short answer. I'm not saying that the category of value is not important today. Now, but we are talking now of a capitalism that lives from future value, and not from past value. That's a difference. It changes the structure of capitalism, and this is a form of capitalism that cannot exist for a long time. It is the crisis. But just this point, because then we would enter in a very economic discussion. More interesting for this discussion here is the concept of class. You said that there is no common denominator for all the forms of existence under capitalism, and you said that the Communist Party would be the agent, or in the Communist Manifest, would be the agent that makes a synthesis, brings together. But you omitted one thing, and of course in the Communist Manifest there is presupposed that there is a common denominator. You have two main classes, bourgeoisie and proletariat, and the proletariat expands historically ever more, and there is a sort of a unity presupposed, like Lukács said, the subject an sich, I don't know how to say in English,
in itself,
that doesn't know, that does not have conscious of itself. And then the party brings the conscious to the subject. This is a very authoritarian concept. The party is the avant-garde that shows the proletariat where it has to go. I think this is very, very out of time and very authoritarian. But that's not only a political question. It's also a theoretical question, because we have now a society where everybody, almost worldwide, is forced to live from its labor power in some way, or selling commodities. So this is the general existence for almost everybody. And you cannot put this in the term of a class. A class needs a difference between different classes. This is the general existence, and we have a lot of contradictions within this form of living. So we have to find another way of bringing these contradictions together, which would not be the class. And I say it's a negative point of reference. The negative point of reference is what I call the form of wealth production on the one hand, and forms of domination that go together with that. The different forms of domination, of course. And so it's the negative orientation against this form of production, which includes form of domination, which might allow to form a new subject in some way, or a new actor of emancipation, but the term of class does not apport anything to understand it. We have to talk about the contents of emancipation is, what the content of that what we criticize is, and then we may find a common point to get an anti-capitalist movement worldwide.
Thanks. I saw one question. Were there any others whose hands I didn't see yet? Okay. Prepare now. Well,
I have a short remark.
I think Dan maybe was first, and then maybe we can collect both of these before.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks, all three. I put my hand up before you just had that last exchange, and it sort of clarified and sort of didn't what I was going to ask, and so maybe I'm just going to push you further in your disagreement. But it struck me when you were speaking, and particularly, I suppose, Michael and Norbert, although I think some of the I was very interested in many of the things Luba was saying about the role of a manifesto, because it struck me that isn't there a way of listening to what you're saying where you're really not disagreeing? right? You're really not disagreeing. I mean, well, you are disagreeing, of course, but I think when we're talking about the Communist Manifesto and its significance, it's really quite unclear to me how you're disagreeing. So Mikhail is talking about the manifesto in terms of a process where there is a group that is labeled as the proletariat by the manifesto, but is nonetheless internally divided, unconscious of itself as having these things, but through analysis is capable of seeing it is dominated by a structure of social domination in the form of capital, etc. And that there is a group of people who I think both actually exist and ideally exist as who are labeled the Communist Party, who see that in some sense more clearly and are more ruthlessly systematic in identifying that shared system of domination. What Norbert is saying is, okay, we can't call that the working class anymore for reasons, as you say, are not beyond the scope of this to discuss in economic terms, but that there are specific fractions of people who are subject to domination in different ways, and you named them, and I thought that's a pretty good list of contemporary people subject to domination, that they are internally divided, in that if they understand their if they organize on kind of a sectional level, they're brought into conflict necessarily, but that through an understanding of the through a kind of correct understanding, as you said, as that kind of negative point of reference, it ought to be possible to bring those people together. So, two questions, I suppose. First of all, where's the beef, as it were? Like, is this just a disagreement over economics and over the word class? Because I suspect it isn't that, but if it isn't that, I'm still not clear what it is. And secondly, I suppose specifically for Norbert, isn't there a role for manifestos then? Isn't there a role for a manifesto, right? Or indeed an organized group, call themselves whatever they like, and yes, not an authoritarian one, not one that believes it knows the truth, but is capable of intervening in that moment to do exactly what Marx believed he was doing with the manifesto, right? So, yeah, that's it. That's the question. The sort of questions, anyway.
I have a short remark. You mentioned this term party, political party, but I as a historian would say that at the time the Communist Manifesto was written, Marx did not develop any theory of political party, and at that time understanding of the term party was very different from today, because I would say Marx understood the term party rather as a tendency or point of view, yeah? And therefore, we must keep in mind, if we read Communist Manifesto today, many terms changed its meaning very much, yeah? So therefore, I would say your understanding of the term party term is rather a Leninist one, because there is actually no theory of party in the writings by Marx.
Okay, I didn't see any other hands up right now, so we think we can give time for some brief answers, and then maybe we would have the break after this.
Two last questions.
All right.
I respond to last short question. The name of the manifesto is the Manifesto of the Communist Party. The notion of the party is integrated into the text. And what I said was the authentic passages from two texts. And it's a remarkable thing that it may sound as a Leninist lesson, but actually these words came from Marx and Engels in the manifesto. I would say that this is the cue for considering a more tiny relationship between Lenin and Marx. And the Communist Manifest, the Communist Party here in the text is conceived as an entity to be done. You know, it is not a fact, but the Communist Party is yet to come.
Okay, so maybe just two remarks on the on the issue of party. As far as I understand, the subject of the Communist Party in the manifesto, it specifically differentiates itself from the other factions of the socialist of the socialist movement in that it is more or less like critical diagnostical in its theory, in its understanding of capitalism than it is in basically providing us with with bright futures as utopian socialisms did. Well, I'm sorry, this is perhaps like the ABC of reading the Communist Manifesto, but still I wanted to stress this. What I think is sort of like hidden in the concept of the party, it's not party as a as an entity, as a political entity in itself, but I think it's an articulative mechanism that doesn't actually reside in the material conditions or in the objective tendencies of capitalism as such. This is, in my opinion, a void or a missing point in many of the readings of Orthodox Marxist readings of Communist Manifesto or historical materialism as such, that they do not simply recognize the political work that needs to be done apart from a certain or a very limited understanding of a vanguard. So it doesn't necessarily has to be a vanguard, a party that would do this articulative work. But I think still there needs to be some articulative and political work to be done in order for the class struggle or whatever kind of hegemonic. Hegemonic takeover and struggle against the info matrix of domination, for example, you can think about. So,
so the writing of manifestos, like this genre that you were presenting on, is part of that work.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that manifesto is part of that work. It invites us to become its subject. It interpolates us to become the political the political subject. But basically that could be. Sorry.
Yes, I agree completely what you say about the party because it was not a concept of party like we have it today, a political party which organizes. It's just a way of putting a position on the plane of political plane, and so we don't have to confound this. There is a difference, a main difference regarding to your question. In my interpretation of the Communist Manifesto, and this is the Communist Manifesto has a positive point of reference. It presupposes a class as an entity. Of course, it has to it tends to bring it together, all these fractions of class not organized and so on. And it's a political question. But something is presupposed, the positive unity of the class. And that's what later on in Leninism and Lukács is conceptualized as the avant-garde of the party and this authoritarian concept of communism, which is completely to be denied. So this positive point of reference is in some way the point for the authoritarianism. What I say is completely different. I say we need a negative point of reference, which is the form of wealth production and the forms of domination connected with this form of wealth production. It's a negative point. And we still, of course, we have this, it's a political question to bring all the forms of protest, of critique together and form something like an anti-capitalist movement, which would be much more heterogeneous than what Marx and Engels thought about the communist or the proletarian. So that's it's a different negative point of reference or positive point of reference. For me, it's crucial. And then, of course, to answer your second question, we need manifestos, but they have to have another point of reference. We, for example, I make a little publicity for us, we had this manifesto against labor. So we have the negative point of reference. We said against labor, not against for not doing anything, but against labor as a form of production and a form of domination. We published this 20 years ago. Now we have a new edition this year with the actualizing forward. It's in German, but we have many other languages on our homepage. So sorry, I make a little publicity for for my position. Well, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think probably it's about time to take the next break. So thanks a lot to all of the presenters.